Good evening. Happy New Year. Happy 1984. And may all your dreams come true in the new year. Welcome to WPXI Saturday Late Show, the last in the current 20-year series of Chiller Theater. They told me 20 years ago, you're going to do it until you do it right. Last week, I did it right, and I'm going on. Oh, jeez. Anyway, my first chiller tonight is the classic Wolfman. And my second feature is It Came From Outer Space with Barbara Rush and Richard Carlson. Tonight, while you're celebrating with your New Year's Eve party, I'll be celebrating by sharing some of the bits I've done over the last 20 years on Chiller. When Phyllis Diller dropped in unexpectedly, Barbara Feldon from the Get Smart fame and Carnegie Mellon. We used to do a thing called the Pittsburgh Subway System, a thing I dreamed up one night in bed. Pye Trainor stopped by. We had poet Rod McEwen come in unexpectedly. My father paid a visit, and we did a bit that I wrote called Mr. Magnificent. And we have other assorted goodies, too. With over 1,000 shows behind us, I only wish I had saved more memorable moments. And we grew on this show from twin projectors 20 years ago, and then that progressed to my walking 21 steps and the sound effects thing, and to a laboratory, then to a castle, a great Chiller family with special guest stars from NBC, from the movies, and from Broadway. And, of course, as I mentioned always, the unexpected. Here's a mic. I always wear a mic. Oh, my goodness. Georgette. Georgette the fudge maker. There's walking roses. Hold it. Yeah, Jack, put the roses there. Holy smokes. The Foley prince. Steve, put those down. You're blocking the prince. Holy. Oh, my. Take the roses. Let me see the cards. Come on over. Hi, Pat. This is Pat Gemeiter, our general manager, if you haven't seen him on TV before. And look at the cake. Fantastic. That? Oh, sure. Nice. And Stevie the cat. Hey, Steve. Thank you very, very much. I've been on a diet for 6 months, but thanks a lot.
I'm made with skinny pepperoni.
Very.
Week after week after week.
Karuku,
beast of the Amazon. Is it on tonight?
Yes. No. This is Frank Gilbert. You'll see him later on the Pittsburgh subway system. Frank was the producer here, and Frank came back. You're going to do PR for the Pittsburgh Pirates. It's a local baseball team, right?
Right. I've heard of them.
And, you know, you're on a subway. I saw it. I can't believe it. Yes.
We're going to fight it.
Oh, yeah, we got it. And Jack. And this is Jack Leroy, director.
So we tried to get a cast of thousands tonight, but we couldn't make it.
That's all
right. Six of us showed up.
Well, you know what? I said I'm going to do it until I do it right. That's when they put me on 20 years ago. I did it right last week, and you let me go. Son of a gun.
But we let you go with a cake for 20 years.
Oh, that's
years,
great.
Okay?
I'll tell you. That's really nice. I really appreciate it.
And I wanted to come by and say thanks for 20 years. It's been super. And
it really has. I have no complaints.
We enjoyed it.
Thanks. Okay. Thank you very much, Pat. Know what? You look in person just like you do on TV.
Good looking.
Keep him here. What?
We're going to go into the movie.
Oh, we're going to go into the
You know what? You can go from editorials to hosting. You don't want to work for Peter.
Steve, tell us. Who's better looking? Really? You want to work, Steve?
Well, let's put it this way. We have two of Pittsburgh's finest talents. Men who are equal in every respect.
Rotund.
Both have been gentlemen in all the years we've been on the show, and I truly mean that.
Good. I want to talk to you later, you know, and Georgette, too, so I hope you'll stick around.
But Pat, he's one nice guy, I'll tell you.
Hey, do you want to do the anchor on the 11? You know, he looks more like Magnum than Magnum.
Really?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, a lot of people think I'm Hank. When I walk into a bank, they don't ask me for ID.
They don't. You know why we call him the Castle Prince? You got to stay loose with him.
Yes?
All the time. Watch it. Anyway, Pat, I want to thank you for coming up. That was nice.
Okay.
Thank you very, very much.
Alrighty.
It was a lot of fun. It really was. We're going to have a great show tonight. Frank, good seeing you. Be on later. Yes. Keith will try some pizza. Steve, you'll be back. Georgette. Well, a lot of others. Stay loose. We're going to bring in the new and the old and naturally happy times. Even though this is the last in the current 20-year series, it's still my favorite show, Chiller Theater. How'd I do? All right? ¶¶ prizes that Steve brought in on the opening, I neglected to read the card. It says, congratulations for a fantastic 20 years. We're proud of you, and you are the greatest. Your family, Louise, Billy, Marie, Lori, Jim, and Kate, my new grandchild. They forgot Max the dog, though. But anyway, thank you very, very much. Tonight, mixed in with the old will be some new. But Phyllis Diller visited Schiller several times, and we always had a lot of laughs and fun. She was always a great person to be around. In the early 60s, while appearing at the Holiday House, Phyllis was scheduled for a live bit and arrived at the very last minute between shows at the Holiday House. Then she came up here. We did a bit. She ran back up. We didn't rehearse. We just did a few bits, and one of them I saved. Why, I don't know, but take a look at this. I think it's pretty good. Remember her?
Oh, do I ever.
I had a nice hairdo, didn't I?
I'll tell you.
It gets worse.
20 years, the years have been kind.
Yes, thanks a lot. You know, Stevie has to run, but before you leave, we did a lot of shows and a lot of stars, but I remember the time we were in Vegas and we were doing a thing for the telethon, and Jerry Lewis and you hit it off beautifully. And tell us the story.
We were doing the promos for the Muscular Dystrophy Telethon. And Jerry Lewis and I and Bill were in the spot, and Jerry put his arm around me like this, and he said, I'd like to thank the Academy for this award, which I thought was pretty good, because if you're going to receive an award, I'm sure I would be a prize.
And there were about 300 people in the Sahara out in Las Vegas, and they went crazy. And then Jerry and Stevie ad-libbed a bit. But, you know, Steve, it was great. I do want to say one thing. The way Steve was discovered for Chiller Theater, I was out there in Vegas about 10 years ago, and I was going to see a show. I don't know what show it was. Do you remember? And this young man came over to me and says, hi, you're Chilly Billy. I said, yes, I'm from Pittsburgh. I watch you all the time. He started talking. I said, well, that's nice. And he says, I'll call you sometime. I got in my room about 5 a.m. I'd just gotten in bed, and the phone was ringing. I picked it up. He said, this is Steve. I said, Steve who? He says, I met you earlier tonight. I said, what in the hell do you want? That's how he got the idea of the prankster. He does it all the time, only now he comes out live, right?
That's right. Now I call at 3 o'clock in the morning and breathe heavy. Maybe you recognize it.
That's you!
That's me!
I thought it was Magnum.
No,
anyways,
that was me.
It's been a
anyways,
pleasure.
It's been very nice, and I'm sure that we'll be somewhere again.
And I also want to say the reason I grew a mustache about 6 months ago, because all the girls, wherever we went on appearances, they always went to him. And then Magnum saw him, and Magnum grew one. I thought I'd try it. So I think Baby Bologna here, I don't look too bad for Baby Bologna.
No, I'll tell you, it's not bad at all. Stick with me. We'll go places.
Yeah, I know where we'll go, too, down to Liberty Avenue. You know, we were live for many years, and after some of the bits, we'd talk to the stars live. Sometimes we'd go to 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and everybody that stayed up with me usually got the inside of the stars that they hardly ever revealed. Stars like... Well, all the actors from Bonanza, from Lauren Green to Michael Landon, et cetera, singers Vic Damone and Freddie Cannon, rock and roll stars and wrestlers and movie stars and dancers, and NBC personalities like Johnny Carson when he was just starting. And we'd do wrestling at 6, and then they'd hang around for Chiller. The live days, a lot of fun, huh?
A lot of fun.
And we're live right now.
And we're going to be live forever.
Say goodnight, Steve.
Good night, Steve.
See you later. Thank you. welcome the new year in with a couple of chillers, the Wolfman, and also the last, second feature will be It Came From Outer Space. Also, over the years, I've written from over 50 different bits. I would write Mr. Magnificent, the Pittsburgh subway system. We did a lot of location bits, Chili's, Phillies, and all kinds of slapstick stuff, guessing games, and what's it. And we used to feature a small wall space in the early days, and we called it the break-in. It would be real silent. And each week when I opened the wall space, different things would happen, many of the times to my surprise. We had marching bands. We had wrestling matches. We had demolition derby. We had a lot of things. We even had a man upside down with an apple in his mouth. Wild stuff, boy. Like this one, for instance. You'll remember it, maybe.
Me, 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 ma, 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 me, me, Figaro, 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 I love myself.
Very interesting.
That was the Kibashi Kid and Joe Bluff. That would be about 1964. Oh, we had a lot of fun in the wall safe. We tried to be current, too. And tonight is no exception. What we did, we'd have Miss America on, Miss USA. We have beauty queens on, beauty pageant queens, Miss Pennsylvania, Miss California, all kinds of stars of the future, too, and some great models. Well, I want you to watch some pictures here of a girl of the future. She's a teenager, the very pretty Roberta Cherko. And Roberta is from our area. She's a senior in high school, and she has a tremendous future in front of her. I just want to have you take a look at some of the shots taken of her in Pittsburgh and New York because she signed on with the Ford Modeling Agency. Mm-hmm. And the different looks of a very pretty girl. And I think, this was featured a 9-page spread in 17 magazine last month nationally. Roberta's the pretty one there. Actually, they're all pretty. And I think this shot coming up is Roberta's favorite, right there. And I'd like to present the star of the future, the very pretty Roberta Cherko. How are you, Bert?
Pretty good.
Do you answer the name of Bert?
Uh-huh.
Do you have a favorite nickname or anything?
Bert's pretty good.
Bert's pretty good. Where do you go to school?
Trinity High School.
And what grade are you in?
I'm a senior.
How were you discovered?
Well, I was at a mall watching my friend in a fashion show, and Bonnie Barton's George at the Fudgemaker came up to me and asked me if I ever modeled, and I said no. And she asked me if I'd like to, and I said, yeah.
Oh, very good. And then you signed on with the Ford Agency. I understand you lived with the Fords in New York last summer?
Yes, I did.
And you'll be graduating this year. What are your plans for the future?
Well, I plan to go to New York, and then maybe to Europe, Spain, Italy, everywhere.
Wouldn't that be nice? That would really be great. What, like yourself, what would you like to do? I know that you're a dancer. How tall are you?
I'm 5'9".
Do you have to be that tall to be a model?
5'9", or 5'8".
Is that right?
Yeah.
Have you been on any great assignments, anything that you can talk about that stands out in your mind, something different?
Well, 17 was so much fun. Mm-hmm. I had so much fun working for them. Then I was on a TV show in New York for Two on the Town,
uh-huh.
And they interviewed me, like, for all the new models.
Oh, they went all around town with you and put you on film?
Uh-huh.
Great. That would be a nice thing to look back to, I'm sure, sometime. You're signed on with Carmine's Modeling Agency in Washington, mm-hmm. And I think I've seen you in the local papers. You're in the Press and the Post-Gazette and that. Mm-hmm. You do modeling for a lot of different stores. I mean, you're not signed on with anyone special, right?
No, I'm not. I do for Horns, Gimbals, A&A, David Weiss.
Wow, that's terrific for a young girl. You have a great future, and to you and your family, I wish you nothing but success, Roberta.
Thank you.
Because this is my last show, and we have a new year, I wanted everybody to see what a star of the future looks like. One that's descending, myself, one that's ascending right here to my right, and I wish you nothing but the best.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
We have some other things we're going to share with you a little bit later. Right now, let's go back to the Wolfman. Yeah. In the early 60s, I would call people and read their horoscopes on the air. I called Frank Siebold, who sent his name into me at the station. He lived in Catani. Stay loose, and as we say, FTA, follow the action with the ears.
The third time is a charm. Good evening. This is Mr. Magnificent.
Howdy, Bob.
Stargazer of the galaxy.
Oh, I'm a geezer of the galaxy myself.
The hawk of the horoscope. His majesty of the mystic.
Mercy.
The pharaoh of the far out.
I'll say, the two of us here.
You do the receiving, and I transmit the messages.
Send it out, mailman.
To all those of you who comprehend with compassion.
Postage due on that one.
Meditate with me now as I get into the super vibrations of my psychic mind.
We're with you, psychic.
There he goes, enters through the wallet.
Our call tonight goes to someone born under the sign of...
Tell us.
Scorpio!
There again! It's a big crab.
And was born on November 5th, 1933.
Boy, he's an old Jesus.
Oldie but moldy. The fortunate individual now about to be called by Mr. Magnificent is...
Sounds like Myron Davis.
All right, too horny.
I forgot. Oh, it came. Frank Siebold in Catani, Pennsylvania.
Frank.
Good evening, Frank Siebold in Catani.
Is this really Mr. Magnificent?
On the phone.
Wait a minute. Kid, wife, come here. I'm talking to Mr. Magnificent.
No, I don't want to talk to your wife, Mr. Siebold. Is all right if I call you Frank?
Yeah, that's all right, Mr. Magnificent.
Frank, I want to talk to you. You were born under the sign of Scorpio.
Hey, that's the sign of love.
I do.
You know, I went to a fortune
teller. Now, wait, Frank. I do the talking. I'm the transmitter. Your moon was in Gemini, you know, when you were born.
My moon was where?
In Gemini.
Well, yeah, what's that mean?
What?
What does that mean?
That means that you're working under two signs.
Yeah, one of them's gone, the other one just came.
Yeah, Gemini and Gemini.
I hope so.
Are you ready, Frank, for a reading? And if you are, what kind of a reading can I give you?
Reading on love.
Love.
Love, that's what I like.
Are you a romanticist, Frank?
Oh, I love it.
Okay, Frank. I'm going to get into my super female voice as I transvestite through the airwaves.
Oh,
are you one of
them
kind?
Listen, Frank. Comprehend with compassion.
I'm holding hands.
Here it comes, Frank.
It feels good.
You don't know? You're just about to find out. How much love can you have? You find that out, too. This is the real thing. And it isn't maybe time, it's yes or it's no, whatever the question might be. The truth is, the decision will probably be his, especially if he's really in a fever. Remember, his key word is passion, and everything he does will be very hot or very cold. This is not a neutral native. Never fool with his dignity, and if you decide to walk, do it gracefully. He's the world's worst enemy. If Scorpio is what you want, put away your autograph book, your roller skates, and your bubble gum. You're a big girl now.
Well, Frank, you're a big girl now. Did you put away your roller skates, bubble gum, and all that other stuff?
Well, I did tonight, Jill, but we're going to stay up late and watch your show. We never miss your show. We stay up till 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, Frank, that's wonderful. Would you say how accurate I was? What kind of a percentage would you give me?
Oh, 99 and 99 100.
Oh, Frank.
It was just wonderful.
And so are you, and I my best to you and the missus.
So, thank you very much, Mr. Magnificent.
Thank you, Frank Seabold in Katanning, Pennsylvania.
Night-night.
Night-night. It's infectious.
99%. Oh, we're
getting better.
Next week, you may be called by Mr. Magnificent.
Oh, hope not.
Good luck to all of my subjects.
Good luck to you too, buddy.
From the mighty, masterful Mr. Magnificent. It's hard to be humble when you're so great.
You know, the crew would surprise me. I always told them they could do whatever they wanted. It didn't matter to me. Thus, we had the first one-eyed E.T. over 17 years ago. That thing was on a lot. We had a smoking patch doll.
Special call for you.
Special call.
Another surprise.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Georgia. Hello.
Hello, Dave.
Hello.
I was so depressed that I started talking. I don't think I'll ever smile, though.
Oh, my goodness, if it isn't terminal stare.
Yes, I got so depressed about Chiller going off the air that I actually started talking.
Well, I tell you, you have a terrific voice.
Well, thank you, but I'll never start smiling.
Well, you know what? You look better with that pout of yours anyway, but how are you, Donna Ray?
Oh, I'm wonderful. Except that I hear that Chiller's going off the air, my wonderful favorite show.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah, well, this is New Year's Eve. It's our last show, and you're in Cleveland now, huh?
Yes.
How's everything going?
Everything's going wonderful.
All
the sports are going well here. Well, we're losing everything, but...
I keep hearing good things.
Going well. Are you going to rent or sell the castle?
Well, I'm going to rent my tux, the highway tux.
Uh-huh.
The castle will probably go into the archives, along with all the other sets that we had. I don't know what's going to happen, to be honest with you, except that it's been a great 20 years. I have no complaints. And with the Chiller family, you and Georgette and Norman and Stevie and Sister Susie, that was a good 5 years.
Yes, it was.
I think we did a 5 years, didn't we?
Time. And now that I can talk, it's so wonderful to be able to tell everyone how thankful we were that they supported us and all the thousands of people that showed up at our appearances and took our pictures and sent us the wonderful letters that they sent us and all the support that people from Pittsburgh and the surrounding areas had for us. It's just, you can't even express it. I don't think in words how grateful you are that they liked us so much.
You're right. And Terminal, I got to tell you, and I hope the other family will hear it, we're booked for Halloween next year, our annual two for sure. I just signed a contract with Century 3 Mall. And we're also going to the Brownsville Drive-In for next year.
Am I going?
You're going too.
Oh, good.
We're going to resurrect the Chiller family next Halloween, so plan on it.
You can only see us on Halloween.
That's for sure. Listen, Donna, thanks for calling.
Okay.
And good luck, honey. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Tell everyone I said Happy New Year, and thanks to everyone in Pittsburgh for letting us share their lives with them.
All right. See you at Terminals there.
Uh-huh. Bye.
Bye-bye.
That was nice. And later you're going to meet crazy people on the Pittsburgh subway system. Pie Trainer, you're going to meet him, Barbara Feldon, and also my father in a bit. 20 years of Chiller in one night. That's heavy stuff. True story, I'm very active when I sleep. And I used to dream of different bits, and I'd get up in the middle of the night and write them down, and then the next day sometimes I would incorporate them in the show. I dreamed of a subway system, thus was born the Pittsburgh Subway System, the PSS. Any stars who would come in would do bits, and of course anyone watching the show that would come up to the studio, we'd have them walk through the tunnel as well. Well, in the early 1970s, on one Pittsburgh Subway System tape, I saved we had a drunk, a vet named Garlou, a news producer, two guests I didn't even know, and others. But let's share some memories with the Pittsburgh Subway System years ago.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bill Cardill reporting once again from Platform 34B of the Pittsburgh Subway System, affectionately known as... And tonight's report is a most pleasant one, as the Pittsburgh subway system...
Rubber duck.
Not that way.
That's not a rubber duck.
No. And you look familiar. Were you here last week?
I don't know. I've been here all week as far as I know.
Hello, Pete. Oh, glad. The low is going to be in the upper 30s. I'm happy to announce that the PSS is most gratified at the response to last Sunday's Subway special of the Pittsburgh Steelers game at Three Rivers Stadium. The Steelers announced only 43,000 fans in attendance. The PSS records show that more than 63,000 patrons took advantage of the PSS Steelers special.
Hey, boy, did you call me?
No, I was calling Bruce.
Oh,
he's busy.
No, yes. Where'd I get the subway to post 1810?
Post 18's down to the right.
The Russians are coming.
Yeah, they were here at 9 o'clock. We can't explain the 20,000 difference, but as we mentioned, that's the Steelers' problem. Our only regret is that thousands of you arrived on our last train that afternoon, Sunday, and were forced to troop through the Steelers' dressing room on the way to your seat. Chuck Noll was a bit miffed at that. Terry Bradshaw had trouble warming up his throwing arm because of all the confusion. Terry Hanratty has lodged an official complaint with the Pittsburgh subway system, simply because one of you grabbed his seat on the Steeler bench. But all in all, the Steeler subway special was a rousing success, and you can look for it again at all Steeler home games this year. It was really something great. Just one word of warning.
We're all busy. What are you doing tonight, big boy?
Go to post 1810 down to the right.
Oh, he's no fun. He's busy, too. You guys are just no fun.
Seating on the Steeler bench is limited these days, according to the PR man, Ed Kiley. We cannot guarantee seats. Ed says he wouldn't save a seat for anyone. After all, Coach Noll has agreed to stand during all home games, but Bradshaw and Hanratty do need their rest.
I told you he'd work it out. Come on.
I wonder if that's District Attorney Dugan.
Hello?
District Attorney Dugan, just come on.
Oh, what happened to the good old days?
So remember, the PSS. Today, Pittsburgh. Tomorrow, the world. I'd rather switch than fight. The phone caller was Frank Gilbert, recently appointed PR man of the Pittsburgh Pirates. And Frank has come a long way for the Pittsburgh Subway.
Oh, Bruce? Bruce? Oh, hi, big boy.
Frank, you're married with two kids, huh?
Yes, I am. I married Bruce. Those numbers just pay off.
Frank, you used to be the producer here at Channel 11 on the news, right, Frank?
That's right, yep, for a few years back in the 60s and early 70s.
There. And then when you left here, you went, I guess, with the Dodgers for a while.
I was with the Red Sox for a while, and then the Dodgers, San Francisco, and then with the Philadelphia Flyers organization, and now I've just taken a job as the promotion and advertising manager for the Pirates.
Fantastic. And it all began in the Pittsburgh subway system.
You started the whole thing. You saw it right there. The whole thing began right in the subway.
See you some games.
One of those numbers paid off.
Keep looking. Get a good one.
Thanks for 20 years, though.
Thank you very much. Okay. Frank Gilbert. Oh, my. A lot of memories. He hasn't changed any. He looked like he lost a few pounds, though. We'll be back more later. Haven't we all? Over the years, I've had about five or six special openings for Chiller. I tried to mix it up a lot, too, but we went for quality. But for depth, when we first started, I had a tunnel, and the camera would dolly up and then go through the hole in the tunnel. Then we dissolved to the other camera. Then I would start the show. Only the old-timers remember this from at least 15 years ago. A graduate of Carnegie Mellon Drama. She was a purring girl on the Tiger commercial. She used to go, all you Tigers out there. Barbara Feldon. Well, she did a special opening with me. And whenever a star would drop by, I would write bits surrounding their particular show for a tie-in with Chiller. She was doing Get Smart. So I got smart with Barbara, if you get it.
It's Saturday night. Time for Chiller Theater. And Chilly Billy Cardilly.
Good evening, all you tigers. This is Agent 99 with two frightening tales calculated to set your heart pounding. Oh, excuse me. Hello? Max. Max, would you please tell me, before you say anything, what I'm doing on this assignment? Well, I'm on this program, Chiller Theater. You're sorry about that. But, Max, you really think the regular host is a member of Chaos? Oh, that's Chilly Billy. You really think he's dangerous, Max? Well, then maybe I could use some help. Right, Max, I'll be careful. Oh, sorry about that. In our first Chiller tonight, you'll be terrified by the living dead as vampires stalk the night. And you'll want to hold on tight when you see the vampire's coffin, followed by a great Bela Lugosi Chiller, the Ape Man.
The Egyptian sneezed while brushing his teeth.
His fleece was white as snow.
Agent 13.
Agent 99. What do you know about this character, Chilly Billy?
Oh, quite well, 99, quite well. Not a bad fellow, really. Not really bad. Not good, but not bad. Why?
Is he dangerous?
No. He's not even a member of Chaos, either.
He's not?
No. The only thing that's Chaos about him is his program.
Oh.
It usually ends up that way.
I see.
I'll tell you one thing, though, 99. You're in big, big trouble.
Why is that? Will he retaliate?
Well, you see, he doesn't like anyone else doing the show. He thinks he's a star. And he could retaliate.
He's in big trouble.
He's a rough customer, you know.
Right.
If I were you, I'd get out of here fast, but now.
Right, Agent 13.
But maybe we should change identities.
How are we going to do that?
Here, sweet. Lots of luck.
Oh, with these new agents, the standards are going very low.
Barbara was very nice to work with, and her co-star, Don Adams, when he visited, we found out that he was raised in Connellsville, and he lived there from the age of 12 to the age of 20. I can honestly say all of the movie and TV stars, from Johnny Carson, Michael Landon, Robert Conrad, Barry Sullivan, were more than happy to participate, and they really got into the bits that I wrote. I wish I had saved some to share with you now, but what's the person to do? I guess Howl at the Moon would be good, because we do have the Wolfman. Let's see what happens with... Ow! I hope you like the classic The Wolfman. It's one of my all-time favorites. This is the New Year's Eve party I've been planning for over 20 years. It was a longer run than I ever imagined, and I loved every minute of the show. I loved to write it, to think of different bits, to look at the finished product. But being a realist, I also knew I would have a final show. Times change and attitudes change, et cetera, et cetera. But I really can say the management of 11 has always supported me. They never tried to suppress me, whatever creative talents I may have and possess. I did some real crazy things over the years that would, at best, fall under questionable. But I have no complaints from the management at 11, having outlived maybe or lasted five general managers and half a dozen program managers. But you know what? They may have some times with me. I like to try different things, and I come off the wall on some. I'm straight on others. I try to mix it up because I knew there was a different audience out there. Some of the adults would say, look at him being so silly. But when I found out that I had at one time 20,000 preteens watching the show, I try to give them something. I try to give the young adults something. I try to give the older folks for the blend and the mix. I try to give a little bit to everybody. Try not to let anyone second guess me anyway on the bits that I would do or be able to predict what I would do on the air. I always try to do everything in good taste and with a touch of class. And if I fail to rub you wrong somewhere along the way, please forgive me. But I can honestly say, Chiller Theater was an honest expression of what Bill Cardell is all about. People would say, what is Bill Cardell really like? And I remember Sammy Davis once said, he's just like he is on the air. And he said that on the air. And that's about what it is. What you see is what you get. Thank you. Thank you, Joe. My second chiller is about Richard Carlson, who in 1961 stopped by Channel 11, and he offered me a trip to California. He says, Bill, come on out to Hollywood. I'm a producer and an actor. I can get you into the movies, and why don't you just leave Pittsburgh? You know, I thought about it for 10 seconds. I said, no, Richard, I like it here. But it was a nice offer, and he called to reiterate that offer, too. Anyway, Barbara Rush stars in this movie. It came from outer space, just like Chilly Billy. Tonight, I am looking back over 20 years of Chiller Theater, over 1,000 movies, and over 4,500 bits. And in the early year, like in 1963, I did a character called Maurice the Matchmaker. Lilies were the flower. I wore sandals. I had costume jewelry on every finger eventually, a cigarette holder. I painted my mustache on myself with a black felt-tip pen, and I had a hard time taking it off every night. And I played a liberated spirit with advice to the lovelorn. And I used to write a lot of S's because that's about all the way I could do with whistling on the S's. Anyway, I had a lot of fun. And I also embarrassed every person who had the name Maurice. With red face to this day, let us return to the good old days of Maurice, who was never known as plain old Mo.
Caught me again.
Brings tears to the eyes.
Hi, sweet. Hi, poopsie. This is Marvelous Maurice the Matchmaker. Here again with tidbits of information for sobbing hearts everywhere. Excuse me. You know, it's so satisfying, sweets, to answer your postal pleas. Here is our first petitioner. Dear handsome swashbuckler, I work at a name withheld morgue. I'm in love with a stiff. I've had it hidden for over a year. What should I do? Sign, Frigid Fritz. Dear FF, you apparently prefer one-sided affairs. I suggest you change jobs. Oh dear, you're liable to get hung up. Take it easy, sweet. Ooh, may we all drown together. Ooh, good. Dear wise one, my sweetie prefers staying home on Saturday nights to watch The Magnificent One on Chiller Theater. I prefer other activities. Signed, Lonesome. Dear Lonesome, stop it. Just stop. Don't be greedy. You have your sweetie the other six nights. Remember the song. Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. Whee!
Makes the world spin a little faster.
our last person writes, "Dear Swingin' Sweetie," ooh, I like that, "we three girls from Seton Hill are savagely mad about you. You should see the Saturday night struggle to snuggle close to you. Signed, three little maids from school." "Dear maids, don't fight, you silly savages. There's enough of Maurice for all of you. Just play your cards right, sweet."
And sauce wasn't bad either. I tried to write with a lot of S's so I could whistle. And Silly Goose, that came from Michael Landon. When he came in one time, a long time ago, everything was Silly Goose, and that's how we came up with that. And Silly Goose to almost everything. You say, "Hey, Michael, what's it like?" I said, "Oh, Silly Goose, it's nice, you know." But anyway, it was a lot of fun. Maurice the Matchmaker. At the time, I remember, that was about 18 years ago. I said it set television back 18 years. Now it set television back 36 years. In the late 50s and the early 60s, I did a daily dance party called the 6 o'clock hop, and I also had a Saturday afternoon dance party. Maybe some of you danced on the show then. Anyway, a novelty record called Ski King was introduced. So my director, Chuck Moyer, said, "Bill, let's put some video to it. We'll go up the Allegheny to Nine Mile Island," which we did. And it didn't matter that I'd never skied and that I almost drowned, but about 22 or 24 years ago, Ski King was on the loose, and he was yanked out of his skis. It brings back memories.
The story is false, but others say it's true. Fear not, old Ski King, 'cause, buddy, I believe in you. The sun was a shining, the water it was smooth. Ski King was in perfect form. Daddy-o was in the group. The pink Cadillac came a sliding in with a big boat on the rear. Ski King stepped out on the sand and said, "The great Ski King is here." On his skis, 50 horses were getting warm. The crowd let out a mighty roar. Let's see that perfect form. He strutted to the water's edge. He waved back to the crowd. He pounded his chest like Tarzan would, and that made Daddy-O proud. Daddy-O backed up close to shore. The rope was a perfect throw. King tied it around his arm and yelled, "Let her go, Daddy-O." Daddy-O opened that throttle wide, sounded like a swarm of bees. All of that power from the 50 horses made Ski King lose his skis. Poor Ski King was a flying low, like a porpoise up and down. They circled the lake about four or five times. Daddy-O never looked around. Daddy-O was driving that boat. Ski King was drinking the lake. People were yelling at Daddy-O, "Stop the boat for goodness sake." Daddy-O finally stopped the boat. He pulled Ski King inside. Poor Ski King had plenty of water, but he sure had lost his pride. Now the moral of this story, keep your neck out of the noose. Be careful not to grab a hold of something you can't turn loose. Of something you can't turn loose. Of something you can't turn loose.
We had fun with Ski King. I have to tell you a story. We loaned that film in about 1961 to the Coast Guard, and it disappeared like for 10 years. And somebody in Hawaii or over in Japan somewhere says, hey, they sent the film back to me. So that's how I got it back about maybe 5 years ago. My shoulders were sore for weeks. But anything for showbiz, that was Ski King. We have some other goodies we're going to share with you in just a moment. Two chillers tonight as we welcome in 84 with our last chiller theater program that started over 20 years ago. And over the years, plenty of memories. I put a bit from Chiller on my album, Chilly Billy Goes on Record. I got the idea laying in bed one night, and I must say, even on Chiller, there was no one in bed with me, although it looks that way. I recorded all the voices, and the quick bit came out like this, part of the live days of Chiller.
Take out the garbage. You answer the door.
Oh, big deal. Answer the door. Answer the door. All you do is take 3 a.m. Answer the door. Take care of the garbage. Take care of the... I do everything around. All right, already. Wait a minute. Boy, oh, boy. And look at the kid threw my robe on the floor. Oh,
answer the door. Pick up the garbage.
Oh, wait a minute. Gee, 3 o'clock in the morning. Oh, morning. All right. Gee, who is it? The Boston Strangler. It's for you, Louise.
I wonder why she didn't answer the door. It was only Tony Curtis with a low but loud voice. Oh, a chilly happening. One cold Saturday night, a very special star came into our studio. Very, very special. And I asked this guest to do something with me on Mr. Magnificent. And we ad-libbed a bit I looked at for the first time in about 12 years, and I want to share it with you. Something special.
Good evening, subject. This is Mr. Magnificent. Stargazer of the galaxy. The hawk of the horoscope. The pharaoh of the far out.
The pharaoh.
His majesty of the mystics. You do the receiving, and I transmit the messages and thought waves to those who comprehend with compassion.
Compassion. Kiss him.
Meditate with me now as I get into the super vibrations of my psychic mind, all 3 eyes. Our live guest in the studio tonight was born under the sign of Leo.
Oh.
And was born on August 17th, 1903.
Oh.
Oldie but goodie.
Oh, he's as old as I am.
The fortunate soul about to be interviewed by Mr. Magnificent is...
Yes.
Mr. Anonymous.
You know, Mr. Magnificent, I've always been skeptical about mind readers and the like.
Oh, really?
So, you've got to convince me tonight.
All right, that's one of the reasons I invited you, Mr. Anonymous. I can't give you background because I'm sure everybody out there would know who you are. After all, the FBI does get around, even though J. Edgar Hoover doesn't get on TV too much. Mr. Anonymous, have I talked to you before you went on the air?
No, sir.
Ask me any questions you want. Personal, anything.
How many children do I have?
How many children, like an echo in it? Nine.
You're right.
Wow.
How many of my nine children are boys and girls?
You have four daughters and five sons. Four and five.
Yes, that's right.
Right again. Oh.
It's hard to be humble.
How many of my nine children are married?
How many?
Oh, he gets this.
All nine.
You're right.
Whoa.
You're beginning to convince me.
Good. Make him tough.
All right. What city do I live in?
You have 30 grandchildren, and you live in Sharon, Pennsylvania.
Right again.
Oh.
Oh, he's magnificent.
One more question.
What street do I live on? What's the name of the street?
Stambaugh Avenue.
Right. How about the address?
37.
Oh, you've convinced me.
Now, wait.
How do you do that?
I want you to know that there's nothing special about my magical powers. I have magical turbans. Now,
magical
have you
turbans.
Ever tried to read brains, mind, waver, and all that? You've never done that, right? I'm going to
no.
give you a magic turban, Mr. Anonymous. Put this on it. I have to place it, though. You can't.
You mean if I put that silly thing on my head that I'll be able
you
to
have,
read your mind?
Don't you feel the vibrations already?
Yeah, I have a strange feeling
all
of
right.
some kind, but what it is, I don't know.
I'm going to ask you some questions now, and you'll probably be able to answer them. Personal question. Am I married?
Yes, you're married.
Do I have any children?
Yes, you have three children.
How many boys and girls?
Well, let's see. It's coming. Two girls and one boy.
See, anybody has that power. So,
well,
but we have to move along, and my name is Bill Cardell. Your name, sir?
Bill Cardell Sr.
Oh, come on.
Yes.
Oh, nice seeing you, Dad. Oh, no wonder you're Mr. Magnificent.
Oh.
It's hard to be humble when you're so great.
Oh, yes, all right.
And to be silly like this again.
You'll never get me into this again.
Next time, you may be interviewed by Mr. Magnificent. Good luck to all of my subjects and the mighty, masterful Mr. Magnificent. Say, it's hard to be humble when you're so great.
It's hard to be humble when you're so great.
When I was a teenager, my dad and I had a father and son song and dance act, and he taught me a lot about stage work and stage presence. And he put me straight about things on the stage, I believe. I'll tell you, he really put me out a couple of times. I listened, though. And my dad loved to do his thing, and he did it very well. It was hard for me to get him up here on the show, but I finally convinced him to come up. My father died several weeks after the taping, but he'll always be alive with me forever. After the taping, one take, I may add, my dad said how he enjoyed working again with me. My dad would have been a big star on television if television had been around when he was young. When my dad was 19 years of age in Farrell, Pennsylvania, he was offered a chance to go to New York and work on the stage. But his family came from the old country, from Italy, and they couldn't understand that, so he stayed in Farrell. He could sit and play the piano and sing and tell stories and drink his beer, and it was great with my parents. And mine are the same as yours, I'm sure. We'll be back with more later. One Saturday night about 3 or 4 years ago, poet Rod McCune was in town, and our director, Jack Blairot, invited him to our show. As a surprise to us, to Terminal Stair, to Georgette the Fudge Maker, and myself, we were about to start a bit when in walked the maniacal Rod McCune.
Count, you sly devil. We're going to find the counters for you yet after 200 years. Looking and looking. Say, you know, if you tell a man there's 300 billion stars in the universe, he'll believe you. But if you tell the same guy the bench has just been painted, he'll have to touch it to make sure. Did you know that? I painted down the north side of...
I'm sick and tired of coming to this town and watching these dumb movies. I wait for the bits. thank God you've got some bits tonight.
Okay. You look like Rod McEwen. Is that true?
Don't spread the rumor. My career in Pittsburgh may be over.
Oh.
The rumor is
what? What? Okay. Rod, it was nice meeting you.
Ladies and gentlemen, go into another channel if you want to see a movie, but if you want to see this,
I hate to see him get excited. What happened? And you invited Rod McEwen on. You said read some poetry, do something. He did something. Can you?
Oh, the rug is on fire too.
Well, it's just, you know what? They say just pretend it never happened. It never happened.
Go ahead, eat the candle. You can do that with the fire. Yours doesn't.
Oh, anyway, what can you say after that? Rod is a hostile poet with the thoughts at times of violence, but very funny and loving man. It was a lot of fun. For over 15 years, I was the voice of TV 11 Studio Wrestling and also the national voice for many years of the syndicated award-winning Championship Wrestling, which played from San Francisco to Maine. I met a lot of great fans and wrestlers, and of course, a man who I thought the world of, a man I still think about often, a man with whom I shared a lot of time with every Saturday night, Hall of Famer, the greatest Pie Trainer. Some of you may remember him from Who Can. I wanted to put Pie on tape, and I asked him just to talk with me. He was a great conversationalist, but he didn't have much confidence in himself. He always wanted something written down. He just would not ad-lib on camera. But let us return to about 15 or more years ago. I have on a very funny jacket with some funny hair, but Pie is handsome and fantastic. Shall we reminisce? Pie?
Pie, this is a time we're supposed to have a commercial about American heating, but let's not do one today. What do you say?
Who can?
We're not supposed to do a commercial, Pie.
I'm sorry, Bill, but every time you mention American heating, I instinctively say, who can? I guess it's an automatic reflex.
How long have you been with American heating, Pie?
Close to 20 years, Bill.
Wow. Have things changed much since you first went on television almost two decades ago?
In the very beginning, they only had live programming for a few hours a day, so we used a lot of slides. In those days of WDTV, Channel 3, the screen would show a slide of me while I talked off camera. We used the same slide every night. One time, when transmission was particularly bad and reception was even worse, the picture of me on the screen had all faded. The next day, everybody said to me, "Were you sick last night, Pie? Your face seemed so pale." Another time, the slide came out dark, and people remarked how sunburned I looked. I guess my health in those days varied with the way my picture came out on the screen.
That'll never happen on Channel 11. Pie, do you have any embarrassing moments on commercials?
I'll never forget the night when I was on camera for 1 minute and I never said a word.
Never said a word? What happened, Pie?
The director told me not to say anything until I heard a voice yell, "Who can?" Well, when the voice yelled, "Who can?" I couldn't hear it because the audio equipment had broken down. So while the voice kept yelling, "Who can?" which I never heard, I just stood there waiting for the signal to talk like the director had made me promise to do. And I think that was the first silent commercial on television.
Speaking of who can, Pie, how many times do you estimate you have said it in the past 20 years?
Let's see, approximately 6 times a week or about 300 times a year for almost 20 years. I'd say about 5,845 times, Bill.
What do you say, Pie, right now about making it 5,846?
Okay, Bill, who can?
American, American Heating Company.
You know, Joe Muller, our cameraman who was with us then, was following Pie downtown one day, and Pie would walk every day, and Joe would go into the front of the building and say, "Who can?" He'd duck, you know, and Pie'd look around. And he did this for about a half a mile.
And then Joe lost Pie. And then Pie was behind him, and he hollered, "Hey!" And Joe turned around, "American!" The greatest. Pie Trainer, a legend then, and now, and always. At the Nixon Theater a long time ago, once upon a time, an occult show stopped by the studios to tape a segment to run on Chiller Theater. It could have been the forerunner to Finger Lickin' Hot Chicken. This tape will be self-explanatory, with more actions in a short period of time than one can find even on Liberty Avenue. Very late. This is a mover and a groover of the occult. A lot of things going on.
Tranquility, far above the cloud, conceiving the heaven, clear, misty shroud. After thus we'll see an end to our home's endless flight and the beginning of the free. Climb to tranquility, finding its real worth, conceiving the heavens, flourishing on earth.
Oh, man, I think the young lady had a head transplant after the heart that she got. Some fire lit, some wouldn't. It was different, though, right? and outer space. We're going back to that in a moment. Will we ever start up again on Chiller? I don't know, but it's been a great 20 years. I do want to thank Bob Willis and Mike Steyer, who helped write the show with me when we first went on the air. Bob was our promotion manager. Then when he left, Mike Steyer, who was working in the promotion department, came along with me in the early years. Also, I'd like to thank Terminal Stair and Georgette the Fudge Maker and Sister Susie and Stefan the Castle Prankster and Norman the Castle Keeper and our directors, Jack Blairow and John Cochran and Galen Spielman and Nancy Duggan and Tony Sermonero and Dick Sylvester, the engineering crew, and I really mean the lovable but crazy studio crew. When we first started Chiller, they were the extended arms, and we had a lot of great times. The Kielbasa Kid and Fuzzy Focus and the Magic Wand and Joe Blitz and all the guys in the crew, they really helped make it a fun show to do. Of course, Yuns, the viewers, it has been magical. It came from beyond space, just like Yuns. Well, that's it. I hope you had a nice New Year's Eve party. Remember, too, that you can listen to me every weekday morning on radio on the AM dial on WIXZ, 1360 AM. Of course, I've been at WPXI since we signed on September 1st, 1957, and I'll be here for a long time. If you ever have to call me, you can... I'm a Chilly Billy Travel. I'm always there. I'm always available. I have already signed on to do the Century 3 Halloween party next year at the Brownsville Drive-In, and the Chiller family will be with me. I do want to say thanks to the staff and management for putting up with me and all my nonsense for all these years on Chiller Theater. And I can't wait till they put me back on with the second edition, the next 20 years of Chiller Theater. And week after week, well, it's a young man. Come here, Mike. This is Mike Cash.
How you doing?
Good. Mike now works for the Pittsburgh Press, but I remember Mike when he was going to Penn State.
Right.
And Mike, you watched one of the first Chillers?
The first one.
When
I was a kid, I was 12 years old, I remember. Watched every week. Then got married, and me and the wife have watched it every week.
You know what? You were telling me earlier tonight that you have audio tapes of how many shows?
About the last 8 years, since my little girl was born.
Is that right?
And then when my little boy was born.
Heidi?
Yeah, Heidi. She's going to be 8 in May, and then Michael's going to be 6 next month, February. So, long time.
This is really a Chiller fan, and that's how I first met Mike. And Mike, you're working for the press. What are you doing now?
I work the overnight shift down there, Bill. The overnight city editor. And do everything. Scrub the floors, do news stories, edit everything. Whatever happens
you
in the
like
city.
You like newspaper work, I know.
Love
that.
It. I love it.
Mike did an article on me in the Sunday Press, I guess, about 6 months ago. I got a lot of comments out of it.
Oh,
and
Mike,
it's been nice over the years.
Bill, it's been a real pleasure and a lot of fun. Saturdays aren't going to be the same anymore.
Well, you represent a lot of people that I've met from this show and a lot of nice people, and you represent them. And it's been a great marriage for me. I really liked it.
Well,
thanks
been
a lot.
A pleasure.
Thank you.
Take care, Bill. Good luck.
All right, Frank Gilbert, come on over here. Frank came from Duquesne University right to Channel 11, and he was in the news department, and they were real stiff. You know, news people are very stiff and polite. That's all right. You know, I always said I never wanted to do news until I was 40, but now that I just reached 40, maybe.
How just?
But I never figured. I still feel that way, personal things, and that I don't think you can have credibility to at least 40 on news. But Frank would come up, and he would be a clown like I was, and did a lot of funny things week after week in Karuku.
Karuku, beast of the Amazon.
And then Frank went on into the sports field. He'd be with the Pirates. What are the plans for the Pirates this year?
Well, we're very happy now that we've signed Kent Tekulve to a new contract. Certainly going to make Christmas and New Year's and 1984 a little easier for us, but we're looking forward to having a real good team. And hopefully we're going to be very competitive and take the National League East.
That'll be nice. And Frank, it's been a lot of fun over all the years.
It's been my pleasure. Believe me, you're the greatest.
Thank you very much. Okay. Frank Gilbert. And our director, Jack Lairo. Come on over here, Jack.
Chilly. You know what? Being with you all these years, you know, it's just been terrific and everything. Oh. But I brought you a Christmas card.
I know you did. Because
Happy New Year card.
This is your running. Jack and Skeets, they run about 15 miles every day. Happy New Year from Skeets Catino in 84.
How are you? You've come a long way from Come Alive.
Yeah, certainly you have. Over the period of years that I've been on many of your shows and Come Alive all the time it was on.
Well, I'll tell you, you two make a great team. And, Jack, we've had a lot of fun. You know, I was thinking of some of the openings that we did. Oh. One of the openings you did in the early days was the clay figures of eight. Yeah. Each, you know, and then they, how did that work again?
We made little animations, and they were clay, and we shot it backwards. So it was actually there, and we'd take pieces away.
And disappear. You know, that was always a clever opening. But, Jack, I've worked with a lot of the directors at Channel 11 over the years, but Jack, I guess, has been the most consistent director we've had on the show. I mean, we would work with, like, a Gail and Spielman for a year, and then you would come back for a couple of years, then somebody else would come on, you get a new assignment. And always did the telethons with you now for about 12 years. So it's always a pleasure, Jack. You're very creative. And I don't want to give this person's name away because I forgot to ask this person, but a well-respected columnist in town said that you were the most creative director in Pittsburgh. And I wish I had asked this person that I could have used the name. I'm sure I would have had the permission, but I don't want to do that. You know, but anyway, it was said to me, and I just want to pass it on to you.
Thank you, Bill.
You've been good, Jack, over the years. Thank you. Thank you, Skeets.
Thank you, Bill.
Turn on the oven.
I'm ready.
I smell gas. We have some people in the studio here and the crew, and I like to get them just to walk out here. Mark Whipple, who is someday going to be on stage with his own magic act, now with Ice Cafe?
Ice Follies.
Ice Follies, yeah. And Mark, I remember, is a pre-teen kid. And we also have some other people over here.
I won't be able to go to bed Saturday night.
I know, I know. What are we going to do, right? Joe Muller, this is Joe Blitz. Give me that howdy.
Howdy, Bob.
they fit now. They're on the age now, right?
Yeah. Well, we had a lot of fun.
We had
though.
A lot of fun.
When
fun.
We first started the show, and there used to be a knife thrown on the opening or champagne pouring when we did a James Bond type opening before James Bond, this is the man that did most of the stuff. And Joe, your creative talents has been appreciated all the years. I really, you know
Thank
that.
You,
you know that. You're great. Thank you, Joe. And Don Cann and Roswell Jones. Don Cann on the crew. He grew a beard.
20 wonderful years with you.
Thank you. Thank you. And your son is great. He's going to have a big future, too. It's been great. Thank you very much, Don. Also, some of the guys that aren't on the shift tonight, too. Leon Whipple is here, and his brother just retired. Thank you, Lee. Thank you very much. It's been a lot of fun. And this is not a sad moment because I'm going to be at 11, and I have some other duties that are coming along, and who knows, maybe with enough letters and things like that, we may come back on with Chiller Theater, maybe at a new time. We always were rated very high, number one, and thanks to you. It's been great. As I've been saying for over 20 years, good night, sleep warm, and not goodbye.